Alright, we're getting started.
Alright, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Anthony, but many of my contemporaries call me Yida. Today I'll be covering some of the basic precepts of a long-hidden tradition in Kabbalah. By long-hidden, I mean little known, even to most of the Jews today. So to begin with, I'm sure most of you guys have heard, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Even though this is quoted from the New Testament, there's actually a hidden reference to it in the very beginning. And so we read Bereshit Bara Elohim, and then it says Et Hashemayim, so we read the heavens. But one of the interesting things that can be interpreted a little differently is because hey in front of a word means the. So therefore, et doesn't get a valid translation in English. Well, aleph is the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Tav is the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So this is a spectrum of the word. And so you can reinterpret et Hashem Ayem. So you can read the heavens, or you can read Hashem Yam. And Hashem means the name. So aleph, tav, the name, yam, referring to the sea, which I'll touch on a little bit. So, as commonly heard, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is kind of a catchy phrase that a lot of people use, but not a lot of people actually contemplate. So, there are 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. There are three that are called mothers. And why? Because you can get the word Sha'ima, so Shin Aleph Mem. And this means mother, or their mother, in reference to say that all of creation came from this, and I'll touch on this in a second. So there are three mother letters, which were here, Aleph, Mem, Shin, but Mem had a final form called Mem Sofit, and so for principality's sake, it was placed in its own division. There are seven double letters, so the seven double letters are Tav, Resh, Dalet, Beit, Fei, Jimel and Kaf, and there were 12 so-called elemental letters, which of course suffice to say if we have four elemental principles, the 12 would be divided 3 to each. So to begin, as I said, there were three mother letters, Aleph, Mem, Shin. So in the beginning was the word. So what is this like? This is like this is like the mouth, the throat. The tongue. And from the mixing of these three principles create all of the other sounds. So what is this like? The mouth is mayim. Makes sound of letter M. And it means earth and water. So water is why I named you Moshe. I found you in the water. I'll make you fishers of men. M, water like marina, or the Marine Corps, which deals with land and sea. We see M, mem sofit, as earth, like the word mountain, or the word army, or the Lord God Almighty created man from the dust of the ground, breathing his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So Aleph, A is air, and we see it like airplane, aerodynamic, aerospace, different examples like that. And S was Shin, it meant fire. We see it like sun, star, solar, spirit. It's in the word like sword, because forged in fire, silver, because it's forged in the fire. So I asked, why was Shin on top? And he said, shh, because we're given for a covering for the light. See, because Shin has alternating sounds, and shh, and shh, given for a covering for the light, like shirt, covering for the light, shoes, covering for the light, shorts, covering for the light, shadow, covering for the light, shade, covering for the light, sheath. How is a sheath a covering for the light, you say? Well, sheath is a covering for a sword. And the sword begins letter S. Why? Because it's forged in the fire. So, these principles, what does this mean? Well, Mem is the mouth, and by the mouth take liquids and solids, Al is the air, taking air by means of the lungs, and S, which is reference to the tongue, as it's reference to fire, and I'll touch on to that later. So, to start off with, of course, as we've delineated, these are the basics called mothers. Shin, Aleph, Mem, Mem, Shin. Now what is this like? Ela separated man from Shin. It's like our head that sees the light, separated from our stomach, processes liquids and solids, but our lungs that breathe the air. And this is scientifically, our head utilizes light, brain fires off neurons to the body, our lungs are breathing in air, and our stomach is processing solids and liquids. All of us have that in common. There's the brain firing off different neurons, principalities, and the light. So we see Ela separates men from Shin in the face as well. This is like your eyes that see the light separated from your mouth that takes in solids and liquids by your nose that air goes through and comes back out of. And so Ela separates men from Shin on your face, and Ela separates men from Shin on your body. And this is every human being in existence. These birds, these holes in the top of their beak, Ela separates men from Shin. Their eyes see the light, and their beaks are taken in the air, and their mouth takes in solids and liquids. Same too with their body, the same structure. Their head will be separated from their stomach by their lungs. All of these animals here, giraffes, elephants, zebras, all the animals of the prairie, domesticated animals, sheep, dogs, cats, all the same principles, eyes on top of the nose on top of the mouth. Insects, exact same thing. So I'll pause just right here for a second. And so what we're seeing here is a quantum pattern. A quantum pattern. I'm gonna touch on to that in just a minute. See the fish, eyes on top of the nose on top of the mouth. Every planet in the universe, it's a body of men, liquids and solids, separated from a centralized star of Shin by space, Aleph. Aleph separates men from Shin. It'll be a planet 1,000 light years away. It'll be a body of Earth, solids and liquids, separated by a centralized star of Shin by space. It doesn't matter. It'd be here, there. And if I go to a planet 1,000 light years away, I can assume, because the principles are the same there, that every construct or every living organism on that planet is going to suffice by the exact same principalities. An example of this. And this is every galaxy in the universe. So just as it is with every galaxy in the universe, all the stars, the planets, land, the sea, our face, our body, the animals, the insects, the fish. All this means is intelligent design. Truly the grand architect. This is definition at its finest. Sun separated from the land and the sea by the atmosphere. Every planet will be like that. Aleph will separate men from Shin. We'll see every planet having a star that it orbits around. It'll be a mass of liquids and solids, and it'll have to have an atmosphere to sustain life. We see this in the division of color. As we saw on the cross, Aleph was yellow. Mem was blue, and Shin was red. Well, we see this in the division of color because yellow mixes with blue to create green, and yellow mixes with red to create orange. So there were seven double letters like I was referencing in the very beginning, and the very first one of these is Tav, which is the very last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, which is to say that these, which are one, gathered into potentiality, which was the end in this kind of creative spectrum. And Tav is spoken by bridling the tongue between the teeth. And so it has aspects of all Aleph, Mem, and Shin for it to be pronounced. And it's TH. It is God's hand. See it like a theos, study of God, theology. See it like theurgy, the, that, this, there, those are all facts. See it like interesting instances, like at birth and breath, including at the word death, which is another interesting one, which means to gather into his hand. So another one of these seven double letters is letter Beit. And so all of these mother letters blended with each other to create these other double letters. An example of this. So the letter B is the letter Beit. So can anyone here demonstrate how to make the sound of the letter B?
Ba.
Ba. Perfect. So can you do that without your lips? cannot do that without your lips. Why? Because the Holy Blessed One bound Beit to Mem and Aleph and placed it to that sign. And so Beit cannot be pronounced without the lips. This tells us that the letter B has the principles of the letter Mem inside of it. How can we see this? Well, if I want to take a bath, where do I take it?
Water.
Water. And if I want to be baptized?
Water.
What is my body mainly made of?
Water.
If I want to blink?
Yeah, cover your eyes with water.
How was I born, the baby and the womb?
It's covered in water.
There it is. If I want to smoke a bong?
That's the water.
No, seriously though. Yeah. Okay, so there's another level to this. And so this teaches us that the air houses the water, but it also teaches us the water houses the air. So how can we see this? What does the air house water?
H2O.
Exactly, H2O.
Rain water. Clouds.
Yep, and rain clouds, absolutely. But let's see that in the letter B. So what's your breath? Take a breathalyzer test, what are they testing for?
The water in it, or the liquid content.
Absolutely, absolutely. And likewise, with blood, that's a liquid that needs air, oxygen inside of it. Moreover,
blood is also blue before it comes out with the oxygen as well.
Yes, yes, it absolutely is blue. It absolutely is blue. In fact, I was told that this was why the sky was blue in the day and black at night, because it reflected the water, which we call blue, and in its depths it's black. Because these properties are bound inside of these words. And now we have to ask ourselves, we think that everything that we're speaking and all of this stuff around us is our creation, and that's just our ego speaking, right? But in reality, there's something far supernal than that, because everything that our ego speaks is communicated through some form of inspiration. It's an influx. Some people call it the flow, some people call it many different things. But the reality, some people call it the supernal voice. The supernal voice is a really good one. So, I asked for the mystery of this, why the letter B was here, and I was told it. He said the mystery of this is Adam. I said, Adam? He said, yes, Adam. See, Adam in Hebrew means blood. He said, air, blood. And where does the air mix with the blood?
The heart.
Correct. And the heart is represented in Hebrew by Lamed Beit, letter Beit, letter B. So that teaches us, what about the breath? It teaches us it's air that houses water. Now we know that it goes to the heart, to be mixed for the water that houses air, called the blood. One and the same. As you had touched on, yes, in the clouds and in the water there'll be H2O. Now, what's important that I'm touching on here is not necessarily that we're discussing language or sounds or anything like that, but it's something far more sublime than that. See, though in the beginning was the word that was spoken is not the first word. See, the first word is called the silent word. The silent word had no voice before there was sound. And this was the essence of principality, which, when expanded, allowed that supernal voice that I just spoke of to speak, which is where the influx of all our inspiration comes from. So I'll touch on a great mystery here. I'll simplify it as much as I can. This is from a very powerful Lurianic text called Omek Homilek. It's by one of the chief disciples of the Arizal. The Arizal goes on to say that, in first, all is word. And he goes on to say that at his simple command, in his uniform will, the word increased to create the world. So what does this mean? I'm going to demonstrate. So who here has heard of the Sephiroth or the Tree of Life? Good. Perfect. Okay, that's really good. That's really good. I'll a very easy walk-in as we get into it. So, remember what I said about the word increasing in a simple command, because I'm going to touch on to that at the end of this. Yes, the water and the clouds. And these principles are universal, so I can go to any planet in the galaxy, and I will assume that the compository makeups are relatively the same in some varying degree. Our blood does in fact take in oxygen. Our heart, as stated, in its two chambers, mixing the two blood cells, lacking oxygen, and that which has oxygen being converted in from the lungs. So, Aleph blended with Shin and created the letter Gimel. So can anyone make the sound letter G?
No.
Do it without your tongue. Because the Holy Blessed One bound Gimel and placed it to that side. And so inside of the letter G has the aspects of Aleph and Shin. And we can see it in a couple of unique ways. We can see it like in the word glow, which would be light glowing in the atmosphere. Or you can see it in growing. If you wish to grow something, you're going to have proper lighting, you're going to have proper atmospheric substance, or atmospheric state. Gasoline, same thing. The emissions are going to turn into atmospheric emission, or the burning is going to turn to atmospheric emission. Remember earlier I told you guys about the word bomb? So letter B tells us water that you need inside of it, right? What is the chamber that you place the water? The G tells us that if you place Shin to it and burn it and progress it, it turns into an atmospheric substance for some reason. I mean, it seems very profane, but the reality is the word is not limited to spectrum. In fact, the word is why things like slang even works in the first place. So Mem and Mem blend to create the letter Fe, which is letter P, is one of the seven double letters. Once again, can anyone make the sound of the letter P? Yes. So, can you do it without your lips? No. Yes. The Holy Blessed One bound this letter and placed it to the side. And we can see some very interesting examples of this. Now, letter Fe has two examples as a final form as well. In English, it's P and F. But in Hebrew, this is one letter. And so the mouth has two aspects. The aspects of your mouth, but you also have the aspects of your throat. You can analyze these in two different ways. In English, like the word cup, so you need to carry, you need to unite peace to the mouth. Like we see F, like in the word food or throat. It also has the aspects of internalization and being within, so like fear. Fear is something that's within, or fun is also something that's within. Or when someone thinks something is funny. So we can also see some interesting examples like the word pipe. So pipe has two P's. So this tells us that there's two mouths and has the principles of liquids and solids. And so where do you put a pipe? Yeah. If you're smoking, yes, you could absolutely do that, 100%. So in that case, you would have in one end of the pipe liquids or solids, I guess. On the other end, you can put it to your mouth, absolutely. And then likewise, if you were in construction, a pipe, in order for you to lay pipe down, you're going to have to, either it's going to be running under the water, or it's going to be running under the earth. And then the other P in the word pipe is going to tell you that inside of that is going to be running either liquids, solids for sewage, or running electrical wire, so on and so forth. Okay, so it's the letter C. It's letter Kaf in Hebrew. Can anyone here make letter C?
Okay.
Okay, perfect, perfect. Can you guys do it without your tongue? Because the Holy Blessed One bound this letter, placed it to the side. Now, this letter, I must say, is my favorite letter of all letters. So this teaches us that letter C has the principles of Shin and Mem. Now earlier, when I discussed the letter Shin with you guys, I said that it meant fire, but I also said to you guys that it was a covering for the light. And so we're going to analyze letter C being used in both of these ways. So for example, what is color?
Vibration.
It is vibration.
Light upon solids.
Correct. It's a blanket of light upon solids. and the letter C denotes that. So what are some of the other examples that we can see of this, like the word camera? So what is a camera? Letter C tells us. Captures light. Correct. What about crayons? Letter C tells us what we're doing with them.
Coloring.
Okay. So what if I want to cook something?
Put it on the side.
I guess I need to, if I'm cooking, letter C tells us that we have to place fire to solids in order to cook food. Or let's say I have a candle. I need to bring light upon solids and place it there. Or if I have a can, how am I to seal it? Okay. So going back to this diagram, and reverting back to what I had stated earlier, at a simple command, the word increased to create the worlds. So, so as you guys can see, what we're dealing with isn't sound, as I was saying, but we're dealing with that silent word that was really at the beginning of creation. What we're dealing with is principality. See, because if I go 1,000 light years away and the planet there I know has liquids and solids, and I can guarantee that it's going to be circling around a centralized star of some sort by space, and I can assume that that planet will have to have liquids and solids on it. It'll have to have some kind of atmosphere, and it'll have to have some kind of light in order to sustain life. I can assume that every plant will, its roots will be in the earth drawing water of some sort. Its leaves will be converting some type of atmospheric substance. Its color will come from the light, be utilizing some form of photosynthesis. I can assume that the animals there, eyes on top of the nose on top of the mouth. I can rewind time and go back 1 billion years ago. I can look at any dinosaur. I can immediately identify eyes on top of the nose on top of the mouth, head on top of the lungs on top of the stomach. I can go before time and assume that all of the planets will be like this everywhere I go. So what's happening here is quantum. In the true aspect of the word quantum, right now in this day and age, the only identifiable truth that is readily accepted is change, right? It's only a real thing, right? But it's really not. Aleph separates men from Shin. Aleph separates men from Shin before we were even a thought of a thought of a thought of a thought, before dinosaurs were thoughts of a thought of a thought of a thought, before any planet was anything, principles first existed to allow creation to exist. Because we don't just randomly generate into things. Every function of every organ in our body is made with purpose and design. And all of this design was predetermined before creation could even spawn, because creation is not chaotic. It's perfect harmonic order. It's us that is chaotic. So reverting back to what I said, in the beginning, all was word. And that is simple, unified will, and a simple command, the word increased to create the worlds. So I'm going to reveal a great mystery here that is very advanced. Who here has heard of the 231 gates?
What?
The 231 gates. Okay, so 231 gates are mentioned in Sefer Yetzirah and some of the most advanced Lurianic texts out there. And it comes from a verse in Sefer Yetzirah that states, Aleph with every letter with Aleph, Beit with every letter with Beit, Gimel with every letter with Gimel. Now, considering the fact it says Aleph with every letter, and Aleph can't pair with itself, that would have a deduction of one. And when you do all of the letters like this, you have exactly 231 combinations. Thus, they're called the 231 gates. This also creates one. So when I say the word increase, let me first explain what that is. So in the very, very beginning, everything is infinite, simple light. But in the infinite, simple light is all-encompassing truth. And in order for him to express that truth, he first had to have a vessel to place that truth inside of. And the only vessel that was fitting for that was the word. And so every letter, principles were placed inside of. And these principles were the construct of creation, you could say, like a programming language, almost like the Matrix. I don't know if you guys have seen the movie The Matrix. It's very, very close to what I'm talking about here. So all of these letters were given these principles. And so the very first set of letters had backs and fronts. Aleph had a back and a front. Shin had a front and a back. Mem had a front and a back. Kaf had a front and a back. And in order that the word would increase, he separated the backs of the letters from the fronts of the letters. And so now you have two sequences. You have two sets of 22 letters. And then, as it is written in Omer Kamalek, the Arizal goes on to state, he then tied the beginnings with the ends, that they be Ein Sof, meaning they'd be limitless, they'd be without end. So what does this mean? So if the very first sequence was Aleph Beit Gimel Dalet Hey all the way to Tav, and the next sequence, therefore, would be Aleph Gimel, it would continue all the way to Tav, Aleph Dalet continue all the way to Tav, except when it got to Tav, it would tie the beginning sequence again. But because the first part soup would be Aleph, it therefore would start off at Beit, then would continue Beit Gimel, Beit Gimel Dalet, Beit Gimel Dalet Hey. And the sequencing would continue like this. When all these 231 gates are added up, which seems like an extremely lofty amount, because it actually really is an extremely lofty amount, 1,540 double letter combinations were created at the first increase of the word. The very first increase of the word, 1,540 double letter combinations were created. So what is the significance?
Are you saying that was created in Kether?
Yeah. Oh, yes, yes.
That's where the word took its first manifestation.
So I'm going to touch on to that in just a minute, and you are exactly correct. But
okay,
this is.
So we're talking the same thing then.
Yes, but this is Kether of Kether.
Yeah, which depends on the translation. K-E-T-E-R, K-E-T-H-E-R,
yeah.
15 other ways of spelling it.
And so you'll see why I said Kether of Kether in just a second. Okay, so. The word increase, so this 1,540 combination. So what's the significance of this, and why did I even bring this up? Like, it's just definitely not to show you guys I'm good at math. There's 1,540 combinations because if you divide that by 22, which is the letters of the Hebrew alphabet, you get 70. Yes, this is the 70 languages of mankind. This is how the supernal voice began. This is why the supernal voice speaks to every man in his own tongue and his own language.
So,
I have here a Sephirothic diagram. I'm sure that you guys are familiar with the Tree of Life for those who are new here to the concept of the Tree of Life. It is a construct in Kabbalah that they use to navigate the mysteries per se. So as I stated, in the beginning were 22 letters. And I said they were backs and fronts. Every letter corresponded to one Sephiroth. Yes?
Can you ask a question? Can you show me what back and front of a letter looks like? I'm sort of confused on that.
So it would look exactly like an Aleph. So it would be if you drew a letter and you could view it in a three-dimensional way, or okay, even a two-dimensional way, it would have one face, and then subsequently it would have a hidden face. And so the hidden faces, which were the backs, were expanded out from the upper faces of the letters. Then they were tied from the back and increased subsequently.
Okay.
And I'll show you an example of that. I brought Omek Hamalek just for that demonstration.
I'm a little slow.
Oh, no, no, please, 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 please. This is very lofty here, so if at any moment you guys feel overwhelmed, please ask questions. I'm here for you, sir. So there are 22 letters. There are 11 Sephiroth in the beginning. I should stop here and make a note. Most of you guys are probably familiar with the 10 Sephiroth, not 11 Sephiroth. And that's because there are 10 Sephiroth in this construct, not 11. Now that's a perplexing statement. Why would you say there's 10 Sephiroth and not 11 Sephiroth? Well, that's because you shouldn't read Beta Sheets in the beginning, but you should read Beit 2, second to beginning. Beit Rashid, second to creation. Because in fact, the beginning was in the end, and the end was in the beginning. That is to say that the beginning of this creation started at the annihilation of the first creation, which was the internal worlds, which is our internal connection to the upper worlds, which is why we come in the world with no connection. It's all annihilated. It's a sea of chaos. So, in the increase of this first word in the first creation, there are 22 letters, there are 11 Sephiroth. So there are faces to the Sephiroth, and subsequently backs to the Sephiroth. And so this anomaly created two trees, essentially, one on top of another. You guys have ever heard in Genesis the bruising of the head? You bruise your head and the other one will wound the heel. And another place, I think, in the book of Ruth, there's a hidden meaning of a referencing of waking up at the feet. Because essentially, these two trees are one tree on top of another tree. And so this created spectrum. And by spectrum, I'm talking about duality, where you have Chesed, Gavura, you have Klipot, non-Klipot, you have upper world and lower world, you have the supernal voice, which was ready to prepare for actualization. And so why did I go through the pain of mentioning all these 231 gates and all these things in reference to all of this? Many, many times in the beginning of Genesis, you'll hear Vaya Amar. And God said, Elohim, Vaya Amar. He says this, that, or the other thing. So Vav, Yud. Vav is referencing to the six Sephiroth surrounding Tifereth. Yod is referencing Chokmah, and Amar, Aleph Mem Resh, has a gematrial value of 241. This is the 231 gates that I just had explained that increase from the word, plus 10 Sephiroth, because the second creation is created with 10 Sephiroth. That is to say that when he spoke something to exist, that word via Amar, it's actually using these gates, computing this ridiculous program, and allowing generation to occur. So going back to this cross, what does this all mean? This was the alpha language. The alpha language was the very first sequence. The very first sequence was the silent sequence before there was any sound that was generated. This was the original code that increased in the very beginning that allowed creation to exist. Because none of the worlds could exist, none of the universes exist. This is before Sephiroth. This is before any actualization. This is and when everything is unified as one thing, and everything is in pure states of principles. So I was covering the seven double letters. So we covered Beit, Fe, Kaf, Gimel. We covered Tav. There are two others, Resh, which means form. And we see it in the word Aretz, which means the earth. The Sadi and Aretz means a pillar. So Aretz could be interpreted as the pillars of formation. For this reason, in the beginning, he creates Hashem Ayam and Ha'aretz. But then we read it's Tohu Bohu, there's formless and void. So how do you create something and then have something formless and void? Doesn't make any sense. And then in addition, it is said by the sages that when the Blessed Holy One says, let there be light, that the light was pre-existent. He says, let there be light. He doesn't say, create light. So how do we reconcile that? And as stated before, the answer is that we don't read in the second beginning? The answer is that the light was in the first creation. This was called the hidden, concealed light. This is the primordial point that penetrated through the top of Keter. This is the mystery of a hole in the head. So, resh, that means form. This means that Aleph separates men from Shin, the air housing the water housing the air, light covering solid, so on and so forth. This means that these principles gather in every single form in existence. Yes, every alien. Eyes on top of the nose, nose on top of the mouth. I can assume if I saw a demon, eyes on top of the nose, nose on top of the mouth, head on top of the lungs, lungs on top of the stomach. If I saw an angel, eyes on top of the nose, nose on top of the mouth. If I saw a Hindu god, eyes on top of the nose, nose on top of the mouth. Vishnu, eyes on top of the nose, nose on top of the mouth. It doesn't matter what kind of, whatever we're dealing with, because these principles have stated that every form in existence, regardless of what it is, as the essence of life, is formed by these principles. The letter Dalet means a path without walls. It was so infinitely expansive, they thought this one letter was God. In fact, the word for God in Latin is Deus, and comes from the word, that's where we get the word day from. It's why the word divinity works in deity. It's because the letter Dalet was so infinitely expansive, it came to encompass everything. So I told you the letter G, it meant to progress. And so that means the word God could be interpreted as to progress the path without walls, progress the all-encompassing limitless. So now we've covered all of the seven double letters, and we've covered all of the mother letters. Then that leaves us just with these last simple letters, as they're called, or elemental letters, as Sefer Yetzirah refers to them. As I said before, they're called elemental letters because they're attributed to the elemental principles by which they correspond to. And so because there was 12 of them, that means there's three to each mother letter. And as we know, though there are three mother letters, as a principle, there's four. So, we have Yod here, coming off from the side of Shin. And what's most interesting here is that fire actually takes the form of Yod. If you ever see a candle, it's the flame on the wick takes the same form. It's a primordial light. Some say that this was the origin of the original letter Yod to encapsulate the mystery of this divine light. So we see it in the word like spirit. We see it like in the word ignite, which all has to deal with sparking and fire. We have the letter Lamed, which is the letter L, and it has two meanings. Now earlier you mentioned vibration. Letter Lamed has its principality in vibration. We see it in vibration like in loud, or listen, or bell. But we also see it used as a staff, which will commonly be denoted. Sometimes it'll be elongated to look like a shepherd's staff. And so in English, there's an anomaly that occurs in the scriptures. Because if we take the L to mean staff, then we can interpret the Lord is my shepherd in a new way. We can also interpret the lamb is the good shepherd in a new way. In fact, we can interpret that entire word lamb completely differently. Islam now means staff, and B now means house. And so lamb now means shepherd to the house. So there's another hidden principle. So as I say with the letter B, we saw one level, air, house, water, water, house, air. And then we saw another level, which was its association with the heart. Every single one of these letters have ridiculous implications, such as we say with the letter Bait. So I'll cover some of them. But for the sake of time, I'm not going to dwell too much on those mysteries. But if you guys would like to know more about these mysteries, I definitely am gathering together works to publish for the first time so that people can be introduced to these types of mysteries that the Western world up to this point has had no access to. Okay, so another hidden principle of this is, so if you see that the air progresses to the fire is progressed by the air, they encapsulate each other. So we also see that in the principle of Lamed, because the varying degrees of Aleph progressing Shin creates varying degrees of vibration. So we have Ayin, which is the final that came from the side of Shin, and it means eyes. And it's the letter E, and sometimes the letter O in English. We see it's letter E like in the word eye. Eye has two E's because you have two eyes. We see it like in the word C, two E's again for the same reason. Sometimes we can see it in the letter O, like optic, optician, optometry. We can see it like, sometimes like a single open eye. Sometimes we can see it like Osiris, who had one eye, Odin, one eye, Thor, one eye, Horus, one eye. The Lord gave this parable in English, which is really funny. He says, if the eyes, right, letter E, the eyes are the light of the body. If thine eye be single, thy whole body, letter O in it, will be filled with light. Okay, so the hidden principle of letter Ayin is, as we had learned with letter C, that the covering of light upon solids. And so this teaches us that all eyes in existence are going to see covering of light upon solids. This is going to be universal. So that means if a creation, because all these principles gather in every form. So this means every form in existence, if they have eyes, their eyes are going to be utilizing the principles of light upon solids. Now I know this might seem like something that might seem redundant and base, but the precepts of this is that all of these things that we seem common sense, it's for a reason. It's because it's all base principles. It's like the laws to reality. Okay, so we have inside of Aleph three letters. This first one is letter He, this letter H. And it has the aspects of Aleph, so how can we see that? See like the word helium, let's deal with atmospheric substance, hydrogen, heat, different other aspects like that. I'll give a fun fact about the letter H. So we have Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet, He. It's numerical 5, gematrial 5. He has two sounds, eh. And so in English, sometimes this letter is played with in words because it can have these two sounds, ha plus eh. And so 5 can be denoted to both of them. For this reason, we see A, B, C, D, E. E is 5 in English. So what is this like? You guys ever wonder why you have 5 senses? Because letter E tells you there's 5. And all the 5 senses have letter E to denote that. So you see, hear, smell, taste, feel, exactly. And so we know E has association with eyes. So you feel for what you see. So emotion begins letter E, because you feel for what you see. Moreover, we now know that it has 5, right? So you feel with what? 2 sets of 5. What are these called? Hand. Hand, why? Because letter H tells you there's 5. That's why you got feet. Feet tell you that there's 2 sets of 5 that you're walking upon. Because nothing that man says is man's. We might take credit, our ego might take credit for whatever hoobie that we have going on. But the reality is none of this is us. This is the supernal voice, whom all things came from and whom all things go to. I mean, do we look outside and not see the grass sleeping, fish sleeping, insects sleeping, animals sleeping, us sleeping? You ever try to stay awake too long? It doesn't work. Absolutely correct. Yes, they do. It's 100%. And so why is all of this? So you can eat perfect, drink perfect, you can have good companionship, all the emotional stimulation you want, all the desire body stimulation you want, all the mental stimulation you want, the spiritual stimulation you want. You can have all the good stuff for the soul. Stay awake too long, what happens? Will that save you? No, you'll go crazy and you'll die. Because there's something more in that than all those things I just stated. I'll touch on a great mystery regarding that at the end of this. Okay, so letter Samech. This is also the letter S. It means cycles. You can see as the origin, this is the origin of Ouroboros. It's the coiling serpent. It's very much related to that. It's especially in the higher esoteric mysteries. In fact, a funny note, this letter is responsible for the destruction of the entire universe. If you guys know, Da'ath is not a Sephiroth, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's why. So, yeah, Lam is Kether, Mem is Chokmah, Nun is Bina, and Samek is Da'ath. Okay, so we see cycles. So what does this mean? It has this relation between the air, progressing the fire, and fire being progressed by the air. And so as we know, like, sun is a body of fire. But Samek tells us what? It tells us that the sun is going to cycle through the sky. If I want to sleep, I'm going to have to cycle for a time. About silver, I'm going to cycle it through the fire. Sword, I'm going to cycle it through the fire. Because these two things are interchanged, and they're one and the same. It's like seasons. So what are the seasons? The varying degrees of Aleph being progressed by Shin, and Shin progressing Aleph. What is the difference between hot and cold?
Degrees.
Exactly.
The energy is either fast-paced moving, or it's slow-moving, or not at all.
Yes, that's also correct. Because the hot and cold is an illusion. Hot and cold is either presence of energy or not presence of energy, is the only deciding factor.
Great vibration.
Yep. Which is to say that these are two different sets of environments from one polar spectrum.
The hotter it gets, the more it vibrates, the colder it gets, the vibration slows to nothing.
Absolutely. So from the side of Mem, we have Vav. And Vav means a nail in Hebrew, but has the sounds V-O-U-W, Vo, Vow. And so, what is this like? In English, it would be V-O-U-W, so V is the tip of the nail. And so this is a directed force, like love, vengeance, violence, vindictive, vengeance. All of these things are directed forces of intent. O is the top of the nail. We see it as a binding, like the word door. You know, Dala is a path without walls. So O is bind one side, O is bind another side. Resh is a form. Exactly what a door does. U is the space between the nail. It's whatever is bound by the nail, two things bound to unite. The mystery of the U is union, unity. To say U has to go Y-O-U to acknowledge that person in unity with you. And W are the many things bound by the nail. It's an infinite number of things. See it like world, many bindings, who, to connect something, what, when, where, a well, water. Why water? Because you need lots of it. You have to continuously return to it. We have the letter Kaf down here, which is letter K in English, and it means a skull. Its principal aspect is bone. And we see its association between Mem and Mem, liquids and solids. And so this teaches us that the skull, which is a protrusion of bone, is in between liquids and solids. So how can we identify that? What's your knuckle? Your knuckle's a protrusion of bone between a thin layer of liquids and solids, because you'll bleed on your knuckles most certainly. What about your knee? It's a protrusion of bone between liquids and solids. What about your skull? Or skeleton. We could say even a king. And in this case, what would the king be? The king's concerned mainly with land and sea. So these letters are quantum in their nature, but they have these hidden principles that universally apply themselves. But the thing is, they apply themselves in the image of their roots and their principal natures. They fluctuate because when the spectrum increased, what we're analyzing now is before spectrum even existed. But once the spectrum exists, there has to be something for everything. Every possible combination. Have you guys heard scientists say there could be an infinite number of universes out there, infinite number of realities out there? Because every possible possibility has to be accounted for. Because that's how mathematics works. Because they know that if there is an increase, if there is a thing, it has to account for everything. The spectrum has to have totality. and has to have exactness, finality, because everything here is finite. We can measure everything here. So, and we have letter nun. Letter nun is fish in Hebrew. It also means a soul, because the word nuna in Hebrew means a fish. And it's where we get the word, you can see an as a fish, like tuna, or navy, Japanese word for a mermaid, ningyo. Or we can see it in an Aramaic word like a Nazarene, because Nazarene is a fisherman. And so we can see it like, I told you guys earlier, letter M was water and earth. I've now told you guys letter N means fish and soul. Obviously it's soul, see it like Nino, soul of my soul, my child. Nafesh, Neshama, Noel, soul of El. No, yes, that's my spirit, wants to do that, support, stomach, yes, I see that. So Y, my spirit, E, to see, stomach, to the ingredients. Or no, new, my soul, Bob, no, not doing that. So in the scriptures, we see two hidden mysteries regarding this. Let's take letter M as water, and N to mean fish, as I said in the beginning, make you fishers of men. Because the word man now means fish in the water. Now I interpret it to mean soul, and I interpret man to mean earth. And we know A means air. Lord God Almighty created man from the dust of the ground, letter M. And breathed in his nostrils the breath of life, letter A. Man became living soul, letter N. And so these final three letters here are equated to Memsofit, and they are the earth. First of them is letter Sadi. It means a pillar to connect that which is above to that which is below. It has two forms, as we see it right here, is its most common form. This is a non-Sofit form, meaning that in Hebrew, if this letter appears not at the end of a word, it's constructed like this. But if it is written at the end of the word, it's constructed differently. And there's a great mystical meaning behind final letters and normal letters, which isn't really applicable or as relevant in English. And so, Sadi being used as a pillar has two sounds. So T and Z. And how can we see this? So we see T like a pillar, like a tree, like a tower, like straight. And the letter C is a pillar. How do we see this? Like zebra. Yes, absolutely. Zebra, Z's are pillars. E's to see it. B's on the house. R's the form. A's variable. It's letter Z. You see many pillars in the house of the form. That's why a zebra stripe. That's why you might as well call it zoo jail. Because what does zoo mean? Zoo means pillars. Binding. Lots of bindings. So we have the letter Z, which is the letter Zang. It means a weapon. It's a dagger. This letter came as a result of Shin interacting with Mem. And so you bring fire to the earth, what happens? Things are burned, consumed, and forged. See, if you bring fire to the air, it consumes that. If you bring it to the earth, it consumes that. And so the mystery of this, we see it used in words like berserker, kamikaze, bazooka, zombie, Zyklon B. All these different words have letter Z to denote this. Zeronpin. See, because who was not in awe of the king of the kingdom of the nations? T letter Tet, which means a serpent, is very rarely used in English, if at all. I can only give you very few examples of it being used. But it has the processes of intellectual properties. So we see it in the use, we can see it in the use most clearly, for example, as a T in the word serpent, but we can see it very clearly in the word Satan, Shaitan. So what are the attributes of Shaitan?
Gabor.
Very wise, yes. Yes, Gabor, yes. But usually they say he's a fire, he's a snake. You heard of that?
Mm-hmm.
Dragon, things like that. Well, why do you think he said that? Well, what is his name? Shaitan. Shin. It's fire. Tet. You think they call him a serpent? Noon. Embodied soul. So, we've now covered all of these 22 letters that are here, and as just running through a base level of these precepts, there are much higher levels. Like, as an example, as we know that Kaf was a skull in between liquids and solids, and we know that the eyes see light upon solids. We know P, mouth, takes in liquids and solids. Everything in existence has a mouth, can take in liquids and solids. Everything that has eyes covering of light on solids. Well, letter K, what does this tell us? This line straight across teaches us that all of these things are in the same place. So the eyes are going to be gathered where? In the head. The mouth is going to be gathered where in the head?
The K and the M reminds me of waters of the mind.
Yes, absolutely. So waters of the mind. She just pointed out a philosophic concept. She said waters of the mind. Have you guys, any of you guys ever heard of that? So waters of the mind, well, letter M begins with what? The word mind begins with letter M. Water. But you see how something deep down inside of us says, wait a minute, there's something there. It sparks some kind of philosophic thought. Deep, primordial, concealed. You guys never thought to think where that came from? Waters of emotion. You know, I know E means eyes, but M means water. Ever thought to wonder why the sun is a ball of fire? What about the moon? Moon, letter M, water. O, nail. O, nail. And noon, fish. And so moon means water this way, water back that way. Fish would mean the sea. Hmm?
You're also right about the M meaning water, because moon in the context pulls the tides.
Yes.
Which directly correlate with water.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. For this reason, in the scriptures, it says, out of his mouth was the sound of rushing waters. And in the same passage, he says, and his eyes are like a flaming fire. Ever thought to think why they're saying these things? We learned the letter P's mouth. He said, lukewarm will be spewed from the mouth. Ever thought to think why they said any of these things? Letter B means house. He said, no, you're not, your body is the temple. The spirit dwells inside you. Why? Well, you know the letter Y is spirit. The word body means house of spirit. This isn't a philosophic concept. This isn't some kind of debate for whatever purposes of self, whatever's going on. They weren't stating these things because these things were philosophic concepts. The ancient sages were saying these things because there is a level to the scriptures that this world has never seen. Truly. And the wisdom of the ancients has been lost. But for the first time, hopefully, in this generation, in these coming generations, it will be resurfacing. And by the wisdom of the ancients, I hope today that all of you guys will have been able to get a small taste, a glimpse of what that wisdom is like. And I'd like to revert back, as I said earlier, I would touch on something at the end, touch on the tree. So earlier you guys might have said, heard me mention some forms. You know, I said your emotion form, right? I said your desire form, I said your spirit form, I said your soul form, your mental form. So these correspond to the Sephiroth. Gavura is your desire body, root of all desire. And from this triggers your emotion body. Your desires are tagged to your emotions. Chesed, your spirit body. Netzach, your soul body. Yesod, your mental faculty, called the Book of Memory, the place of 70 crowns. And then Malchuth, physicality, finality. So, but you, earlier you guys heard me say, you have an emotion body, you have a desire body, you have a spirit body, you have a soul body, you have a mental body, and you have a physical body. But you know what the real reality of all this is, though? The reality is, you're none of those. The reality is that you're infinite. You're Ein Sof, because the Father's Ein Sof. Right? You guys are an infinite expression of God with unlimited potential. There is no limitation besides the limitation we place ourselves on. This is the mystery of Tifereth, who's called Israel. Why is he called Israel? Don't read Israel. Read Israela. Resh Lamed Aleph. Resh 200, Lamed 30, Aleph 1. As in, is 231 gates. And Yesh means celestial substance, as it is written in Eitzheim. Yesh Ma'ayin, something from nothing. Ayin Ma'yesh, nothing from something. We're an infinite expression, expressing ourselves in our desire body, expressing ourselves into our emotions, expressing in our spirit, gratifying our soul substance. We need physical needs of nourishing, for whatever kind of substances we need, mental substance, and physicality, physical substances. But the reality is, as I stated, you're none of those things. And why did I say you're none of those things? Well, take for example, if you were just stay awake alone, no sleep, and you had all your desires met, you did everything, every desire that came to your heart, you acted on. Every emotion that came to your heart, you acted on. You emotionally gratified yourself to the nth degree. Spiritually, you prayed all day, you went to church, whatever you needed to do to have a spiritual experience. Gratified your soul. Everything you need to do, care for yourself, room for your body, do all that good stuff. Even had good mental stimulation. Talked about new show, whatever the case is, or whatever's going on, mental stimulation, mathematics, doesn't matter, anything. Physical. Eat, drink, breathe air. You stay awake here too long, what happens? Will those save you? Will those carry you in the end? No. They can't. Because you're not any of those things. Infinite light. All of you. And that infinite light expresses itself in those forms. For this reason it says, gather yourself, O Israel. The mystery of this is because you're not any of these forms, you're your infinite form. See, because if you go over here, you're going to hate this. You go over here, you're going to hate that. That's the mystery of good and evil. What is good and evil? Good and evil is the splitting of the Blessed Holy One. It was said to Adam, you can eat of every tree of the tree of the Garden of Eden. Problem is, you have to eat it in wholeness. Eat it and split it. What happens? Death. Because the Blessed Holy One, what does it say on the seventh day? It doesn't just say he saw everything and saw it was good. It was very good. On the seventh day, he looked at all the creation that he had created, all the things he had created. And behold, it was very good. And he rested. So that's a conundrum there. If everything's very good, then what's happened? Well, the reality is that we split ourselves from that understanding. They used to say that Adam, the very first Adam, could see from one end of the world to the other end. They said, well, how can he do that? Does he have like supervision? Can he see all the way to Jerusalem? No. He could see from the end of this world, which is right here. In the beginning of that upper supernal world, which is right over there. And he could see the whole process of creation. He was walk in link with the Blessed Holy One. So when he walked outside and he looked at that tree, Ela separates man from Shem. He walked out, saw that animal, Ela separates man from Shem. Saw that fish, Ela separates man from Shem. He saw his enemy, Ela separates man from Shem. So I'll end this all with one of the most powerful revelations that has never been revealed before, not in the context as it has been today. So, do you guys remember the Tav in the middle here? And we understand this was God's hand, like Pharaoh's theology, God, that is there, those. Well, it's a double letter. And by double letter, God, God's hand is TH, but T can also mean a hand. And like touch, tattoo, take, technology, technician, all of these things have to deal with the hand. So bearing that in mind, the tab in mind, and the ALS effort has been from Shen, take a look at this. This right here is a plan of the Solomon's Temple. The temple after Solomon's Temple, so Herod's Temple. And this is directly lifted from the Talmud. Now I'm going to reveal a great mystery about this temple, which, as I've said, has never been revealed before. So this is a diagram that I have from this manuscript here. And this is showing the layout of the tabernacle. So if you guys remember the Tree of Life down here, it's interesting. On one side, of course, you have Fire Gate. And then on the other side, we have Water Gate, which is like Chesed and Gevurah. Now, of course, you might ask yourself, well, why is the Fire Gate not on the right, and why is the Water Gate not on the left? Or vice versa, or whatever the other cases are. Why sometimes they're switched, like inside? Well, the mystery of this is the Arizal goes on to state that that'll happen when the left is in the right.
See that one more time?
That'll happen when the left is in the right. When the left is in the right. It's the mixing of colors. And so in the Holy of Holies, there were three principal items that were left on display at all times and were tended to by the high priest and the high priest alone. They were the altar of incense. It's Aleph. On one side of that, Mem, Shubret. The other side, Shin, golden menorah. And so the Kohen, symbolic of Tav, by his hands, is reenacting creation before the veil of the Blessed Holy One. How's he doing this? Well, took Mem, ground it down, mixed it with liquids, placed it in Shin. And it lifted, and behold, the air was bound in between. Went over to the gold menorah, tended to it, and behold, the fire covered the solids. It goes over to the altar of incense, mixes them, one and the same, Mem, Shin. It's a savory incense. These are alchemical equations that are being reenacted in the Holy of Holies by the Kohen, by the high priest. Which is the mystery of letters. And the reason why I say it's a mystery of letters is because it wasn't until Moshe came along that holiness could be embodied. At the time of Abraham, what the Sefer Yetzirah is attributed to, he could not actualize holiness. He could contemplate holiness, sure. He couldn't actualize it. And then when I word actualize, I mean literally actualize it. You know, I don't know if you guys ever heard this, but you guys probably heard in the days, then Seth bore Enos, and then man became, came to call on the name of the Lord. Have you guys heard that? Okay, so Adam bears Seth to replace Havel, and Seth bears ascending Enos. And it says that in those days, men began to call on the name of the Lord. Except in Hebrew, the word call on is spelled deficiently. It's actually spelled in a word like to profane it. To profane it. See, and it's strong. What a conundrum. You mean to say that they were calling on the name of the Lord? Well, there's a bunch of conundrums that happen in Genesis. All the thoughts of man's heart was evil continually. And so the real reality is, well, the principal sages say that they had access to this. These hidden keys, these hidden understandings about the gates, etc., 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 and that back then they were able to actualize Torah and actualize wisdom by calling on the names of God and literally manipulating reality. Like, I know it might seem really hard to comprehend them, but I'm not talking about any goetic or ceremonial garbage. I'm talking about these people who are doing stuff that we can't even fathom. You see these superstructures that were made? You see all these pharaohs holding giant tuning forks? It's all a mystery of sound. Our ancients need something we've lost. But with that, I'd like to wrap it all up, and I'd like to thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to speak to you guys and expound on some of these deeper mysteries. And I hope if you guys take anything away from this, you guys get a deeper insight and taste for Kabbalah.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
The Shekinah.
Oh, yes, please.
You have the inner sanctum in there.
Yes, sir.
Fire, the table of incense, which is here, and then you have the bread, and the Shekinah would come from the altar, correct? How does that, and the Shekinah being the, they say, the physical presence of God.
Yes.
Family.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
And was in the temples, and they lost that every time they were there. But how does that play into the letters?
So, I'm glad that you asked that question.
That's so good.
Okay, so, this is a bonus here. Okay, everybody, it's very bonus. It's very advanced.
I asked Sarah, he didn't know.
Oh, yes, yes. This is super advanced, but I'm gonna give you guys the 100% authentic, no BS answer. What I'm about to say may shock some of you guys, really. It really might. Anything that I'm saying right now, of course, I encourage you, you will have to 100% fact verify. Okay, so this is like very, we're entering behind closed doors, behind the veil, at the master's table right now. I'm about to say it's off the rector. All right, so you guys remember I told you guys about this 231 gates expanding, correct?
Mm-hmm.
This is Omer Kamalan. It is not in English, unfortunately. I thought about possibly translating it myself, but hopefully in the future it will be. These are the gates. They're right here. Okay. So this is the gate, Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet. And so what's important to note is, you guys kind of see how everything's kind of like yin and yang? Everything looks kind of pretty okay there? So Partsuf of Kether, perfectly okay. That's the face of Kether, perfectly okay. We get to Hokma, face of Hokma, everything's okay. Oh, we get to Bina. Wait a minute. This last line, there's a break. I mean, there's a break in the last line. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the mystery of the shattering of the vessels. I don't know if you guys know about the shattering of the vessels, but this is the exact moment it occurred.
Say that again, and that's in Bina, you're saying?
Yes. At the very last point sequence of line of Bina, it shattered.
Is that out of the Zohar? Or is that out of, because they talk about the shattering of the wall, or one of them talks about it?
Yes, absolutely.
In the Adam Kadam, K-A-D, Kadam, Tree of Life, they reversed that, and they kept their Bina, Hokma. And that would follow back to the very early ages of when the Canaanites came in and put Bina and the mother goddess out of place, which is Shekinah.
Yes.
And, you know, balance it, turn it around, because in, as you were just talking about the physiological aspect of the letters, the life breath, father doesn't make son to make mother. Father, mother makes son.
Okay.
Yes.
So, very wise, I'm going to touch on that. You are 100% correct. And this is, okay.
Can I quote you on that, please?
Yes, no, yes, you are 100, yeah, no, you can, yeah.
From a lofty tree,
100%. So this is the mystery of shattering the vessels. And so what happens, as I said, there's a part two for Aleph, a part two for Beit. So there's a part two for every single Hebrew letter, for all 22 letters, right? So as I said, so this is the breaking sequence of Bina, which happened. And then we see this would be Da'ath, broken sequence. Broken sequencing. And so what happens is everything is now breaking. And so this is the mystery if you tie the beginnings with the ends. And so what I'm doing is, what I'm highlighting is on the right side, Tav, so the first sequence. And then I'm highlighting the beta sequence that's tacked at the end, following the Tavs. And so something really strange happens at the very, very end of all of these sequences. And that is, in the final partsuf of Malchuth, everything becomes solid. It's bricked, as if we just watched light become solid. Now, what's really interesting is let's draw that in a circle. Well, I'm sure, I don't know if there's any Rosicrucians here, but if anyone has studied any of those esoteric principle texts, they should know about a thread dropping down. So that thread is also very similar to this final participle of Malkuth. If you drop the final participle of Malkuth in a circle, it has a line going directly down the center of it. And so why do I bring all of this up? In the book of Job and in the book of Isaiah, it says that there's a coiled Leviathan that is slain by a great and mighty sword. The word great is gadul, mighty, gavurah. Gadul is chesed. Mighty is gavurah. These are aspects of harmony. A sword is a word. So a word split. The coil of life. And he says that it's tossed into the sea to sustain the righteous. And to sustain the righteous, well, righteous is Esau. He's called righteous. So the mystery of this is that the top line of the sequence, this very alpha line, has no tack on to the end of it. And so therefore, though everything stemmed from this, it itself is exempt from everything else. So though everything extended from this alpha line sequence, it itself is exempt from everything else because everything else underneath it is a beta sequence. And so this is called the concealed one. And this concealed one is equated with that concealed, or what they call the fleeting serpent, which is a horrible, erroneous, atrocious translation of what it says in Hebrew. But the concealed Leviathan is more proper. And that is to say, that it's concealed because it's this top line. And then the other one is called the twisting or coiling Leviathan. And why is it called twisting? Because if I drew all these parts in a giant line going straight up, notice it wraps like a candy cane? That's the Leviathan that's coiled. And so why was it slain to sustain the righteous? Because back when everything was pure in the alpha line, back when the backs of the letters were connected with the fronts of the letters, everything was just pure principle. Everything was just pure principle. Everything was pure principle there. And when the backs were split from the fronts, he subsequently increased the word and then tacked the backs to the fronts that they'd be ayin sof. And so that increase caused all these chaotic combinations. And so that pure light that had been all the way at the top in union with the concealed light was now surrounded by what's called klipo, or husks, or shells, which were chaotic combinations that had been created as a result of the increase of the word. But because the word increased, the spectrum for creation came into existence. That's the possibility for creation. And so in this sense, this is Shekinah. This is the Shekinah. She is the coiled Leviathan, who is Halilah, who is called the earth, who is called Ha-Aretz. Because why Hey is Shekinah? It's the last of Yod Heh, which is Malkuth. And then Aleph is two Yod Vav Yod. It's the mystery of Yod Heh. But secretly, there's two Vavs on Aleph. It's Yod Vav Vav Yod, which makes the gematria of 32, which are the 22 letters and 10 sephiroth. And then Resh is a form, and Sadi is a pillar. So Ha-Aretz means the pillar of deficient light, because R is spelled deficiently there. See, the word R for light is Aleph Vav Resh. And so therefore, later on, we see the word light deficient, spelt when in relation to the firmament. Let there be light in the firmament. Well, the word light there in Hebrew, Amaret, is spelt, Ma'aret, is spelt deficiently. The proper word is Oy. It should have a Vav in it, but there's no Vav. And there's a mystery why that is deficient. Why is it deficient? Because Shekinah is also called the land, who's also called the earth. And the dough, and she's also called the dust. So Ha'aretz comes to symbolize that pillar of deficient light that I was talking about. And so as I told you guys in the beginning, I said, don't read Hashem I Am, don't read the heavens. I said, read Et Hashem Yam. Well, I said that because if we draw those 231 gates in a nice circle, we have a nice pretty sea with a primordial point directly in the center, which is the mystery of the supernal voice. But if we draw the 231 gates as a line, we have a nice huge Leviathan. And so one of those esoteric sections of the Zohar in reference to a donkey driver, his name was Rav Ham Nuna, which you, I told you guys Nuna means fish, but Ham, don't read Ham, read Ma. What fish? Because Ma is a name for Shekinah. So what does this mean? He says, well, my son, he takes the role of Messiah, he says, I am the son of a fish, and a great mighty fish, and that he could swim the ocean in one, he could swim the entire sea in one instance, one movement. Well, how could he do that? And he says that he's Nun. Well, Nun is Binah, so he's the upper Shekinah. He's saying he's being birthed from the upper Shekinah, but how is this possible? What is he actually saying there? Well, how can a fish swim an entire sea in one instance? Well, if we draw the 231 gates like a circle, we get a sea. If we draw the 231 gates like a giant pillar, then we have a coiled snake. And so it is written, the Blessed Holy One makes a way through the sea. And so I said, don't read the heavens. I said, read Et Hashem Yam. Et Hashem Aleph Tav Hashem. That the name of God is the word, Aleph Tav. I am the beginning and the end. And that this is the Alpha sequence called heaven, which is the mystery of that concealed light, which was revealed when we said, let there be light. That's where that light came from. The Alpha sequence, which is called the heavens, which is called the concealed Leviathan. And then the coiled Leviathan is Ha'aretz, who is Shekinah. And so, how did she come into play? Because the top then becomes masculine, and she drops all the way to the very end of the sequence where everything is solid, and that's where she's at. And so, she cannot sustain by herself, so she has to receive the influx from above.
But she travels through the seven heavens to do that.
Yes.
When it goes through again, you're back to the husks, you're back to the rest of that. Mm-hmm. Because when man was evil, she left the earth.
Yes.
And then she has come back because of the five great saints.
Yes.
I can't remember their names, but you know, Moses, Levi, but she manifested once again back in. And they say she is the embodiment of the unknown body. You know?
Yes.
And that's when you were showing up there, you know, shows it.
And so Shekinah would actually be this golden box in the back behind the veil.
Yeah, she is.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, 100%. No, 100%. 100%. And so here's another thing. So Isaiah says this. Isaiah says that the lamb, the coiled Leviathan, was slain to sustain the righteous, and that the sea became wine, right? And that its flesh was like bread. Well, we see later the lamb slain from the foundation of the universe. And so I have a Hebrew copy of the book of the New Testament from Jerusalem. And there were some rabbis that preserved copies of Hebrew copies of the New Testament. And these Hebrew copies were preserved mainly in the hands of critics. Not people that were trying to, they weren't Christians that were preserving them. Basically, they were verbatim critics.
Coptics and some of those.
Mm-hmm. And so the word lamb in Hebrew is shah, shin hei. Well, guess what the word woman is? Aisha. Aleph shin hei. Because the slam slain from the foundation of the universe, which sustains all things, is completely identical with that same sequencing that we just described, which allowed the spectrum for all creation to exist, which the sage is called the coiled Leviathan. And if you read the book of Job, chapter 49, the Blessed Holy One says he will never stop ceasing praise for the limbs of the Leviathan. He says, will it supplicate for you? Will it make a covenant with you? And another thing, they say, who controls the rain? The Blessed Holy One alone. Well, along came Elijah, and he controlled the rain, brought it down through his prayer. Who controls the sun and the moon? The Blessed Holy One alone. Along came Joshua. He controlled the sun and moon. As is written, the sun stood still and the moon halted in its place. Who controls heaven and earth? The Blessed Holy One alone. Along came Abraham and established it firmly. And earlier you guys might have heard me say, who is not all of the king of the kingdom of the nations? Now here's a real scary thing. Yahu is called King of Israel. And who was not in awe of the King of the Kingdom of the Nations? See, because the real answer is who is the hidden name for the Blessed Holy One. And so all those times where you see Job, who laid out the firmament? Who stretched this out? Who stretched that out? Who did this? Who did that? Who did this? Those aren't questions. See, there's no question marks in Hebrew. These are dead fact statements.
Or what?
Or what? Exactly. What is the name for Shekinah? Or both of these different things. And so as you can just see, just in that one instance, if you read the scriptures and interpret those questions, who as statements, or what as statements, all of a sudden that completely reiterates everything that's done. Who's going to help me? Who's going to save me? You're right. Who will save me? 100%. Yeah, that's the truth. Yeah. So, once again, I thank you guys. Thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to talk about this. I actually have a YouTube channel. It's called Restoration of the Breach. If you guys are looking into studying any of the mysteries of the Zohar, I'm actually doing a YouTube series that is going line by line in the Zohar and lifting the highest level of mysteries that have ever been revealed regarding the Zohar in a Lurianic way. Serious keys. So I encourage all of you guys to check that out. I mentioned a couple of books at the end that were never published in English, so I'll tell you guys where you guys can find that. There's another YouTube channel I should add. His name is The Chief Magician of Mystery Babylon. He is a ridiculously advanced Mechabel, a true Mechabel. His level of scholarship is par none. He is the first person in the world to translate all of Tikkun Neha Zohar from Aramaic into English in 3 volumes, over 1,000 pages. Yeah, it's all 3 volumes for sale. You can obtain it for the first time ever. Tikkun Neha Zohar, meaning keys to the Zohar. You can't even read the Zohar until you know what it's actually talking about, because that's a conundrum. Mm-hmm. He also published Sadiq Yisad HaOlam, which is another extremely esoteric text regarding the Book of Ruth. And the final text they did is Mystery of the Engraved Letters. And this is another Lurianic text. So if you guys are learning about the Hebrew letters and wanting to learn about some of the more advanced stuff about emanation, Kabbalah, those books will greatly steer you guys in the right direction.
You said that was Chief Magician of Babylon?
Chief Magician of Mystery Babylon.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
The Mystery Babylon?
Mystery of Babylon,
yeah. Thank you.
It's kind of complicated
sometimes. I know. Okay.
Yes, 100%. So, is there any questions anyone had?
This was amazing.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Oh,
more
thank you.
Guys.